Welcome all to the lecture on Introduction to Abrasive Machining Process and Grinding as a part of the course on Advanced Abrasive Machining Processes. I am Dr. Munish Mukhopadhyay of Mechanical Engineering Department, Meghnad Saha Institute of Technology. Now, the syllabus of the course. There will be four lectures. The lecture 1 will be on Introduction to Abrasive Machining and Process, which is this lecture. Lecture 2 will be on Lapping, Honing and Super Finishing Process. Lecture 3 will concentrate on working of abrasive jet machining, abrasive water jet machining and ultrasonic machining processes. And lecture 4 will be focused on PM EDM, that is powder mixed EDM process, ECD, electrochemical discharge machining, electrochemical dressing, ELID and ECH. Now, jumping on to the start of lecture 1. Coming on to the start of the lecture, we will be starting with getting an idea about manufacturing. I hope from earlier knowledge you might be aware that abrasive machining or machining as a whole comes under the category of manufacturing. Now, what is manufacturing? Successful creation of man's material welfare depends mainly on the ability of natural resources and exertion of human efforts both physically and mentally and development of machine tools. So, in broad view, manufacturing is the conversion of raw material having inferior qualities using certain energy to finished products having superior quality. For example, we can easily see in the slide that conversion of this furniture, of this dining table has been from a raw material, that is the logs of wood. The log of wood for this purpose are the raw materials having low quality, poor dimension as they are not having the specific dimensions required for the furnitures, then they have poor surface quality compared to the furniture. And whenever with different manufacturing processes, that is the value addition processes, they are being converted into a high value product. For example, furniture or dining table in this case, it is generally having a much improved and higher quality. It is having better dimension, better dimensions overall. The usability of this product is much higher compared to the logs whenever it is used for dining purpose, which is the furniture which is being used for. Then comes the surface quality of the furniture which has been made from the logs of wood is comparatively much better. Now, coming on to the classification of manufacturing process, there is machining process, forming process, joining processes, casting processes, powder metallurgy, sheet metal processing and other finishing processes. Among these, machining and finishing processes are the ones that come under the category of abrasive machining process. Normally, abrasives are used for machining as well as finishing, which are nothing but subtractive manufacturing process. Here, the material removal takes place by the relative interaction of the abrasives with the workpiece substrate. Apart from that, there are different parts of manufacturing processes. I hope that you have read about each of them. In this series of lecture, we will be only concerned about this machining part and this finishing part, as all of the things which we will be studying or which we will be going through comes under the category of machining and finishing. Abrasive machining uses hard non-metallic particles to cut the workpiece. Unlike most other major machining operation, this group of processes can shape work pieces harder than 400 HV, that is Vickers hardness number. Abrasive machining produces smooth surface finishes and enables close control to be maintained over the amount of workpiece material removed. In consequence, it is mainly used for finishing operation. The classification of abrasive machining can be seen in the slide. Among these abrasive machining processes, grinding enjoys a very special preference due to its wide usability. Now, if we see the classifications, they are broadly classified into three parts: coarse, medium and fine, according to the level of finishing or the level of surface roughness which they provide. Fine surface roughness means they will produce a much smoother surface compared to the machining processes over in coarse grinding process, coarse machining process. In coarse machining process, we can see grinding, bench grinding. The grinding means surface grinding, creep feed grinding, cylindrical, centerless. We'll be getting to know about all of these in the next slides. Now comes sandblasting, wire brushing. Sandblasting is used in order to remove the oxide from the material surface. Now, wire brushing, they also are used for similar purposes. Then comes mass finishing operations in medium. Then coated abrasives are used for obtaining medium level of surface finishes. Then honing is a machining process which comes under this category. In fine abrasive machining processes, polishing and buffing or lapping, super finishing are there, and there are certain other manufacturing processes which are part of abrasive machining technologies, but the effect of the process is somewhat not related to obtaining the high quality surface finish which is observed or which is expected from these operations. There are abrasive flow machining, electro polishing, electrolytic grinding, chemical machining or polishing, then polishing using magnetic field, etc. Now, coming on to history of grinding, the story began with primitive man, who probably found that he could sharpen his flint knife by rubbing it against a piece of sandstone. Very easy, we might have done that ourselves. So not flint knife, of course. This is a flint knife. Very early age tool which the early man used. At a later stage, prior to the invention of pottery, abrasives were used for grinding out stones to make eating utensils. This may be earliest use of grinding as a machining operation to obtain a desired shape, rather than just for sharpening. The huge stone blocks used in building of pyramids were cut to size by sawing with some crude type of grinding machines, and their surface were smoothed with sandstone. Grinding of metal began in ancient Egypt in about 2000 BC, which corresponds to the beginning of metallurgy. During this period, grinding skill became highly valued in the Middle East for sharpening of tool and making ornaments. The concept of producing grinding wheel began with Franklin Norton and Frederick Hancock at the pottery in Worcester, England. In 1858, their company focused on redware items and stoneware potteries to manufacture diverse objects such as jugs, bottles, spittoons, etc. In 1873, an employee, Sven Paulsen, invented a kiln fire grinding wheel shaped from a mixture of powder, clay and water. The problem with the wheel was that it eroded very fast. However, it provided an innovative idea based on which people produced abrasive wheel of better quality later on. By the late 1880s, grinding wheel was considered to be an essential tool in every modern machine shop. With the introduction of silicon carbide and aluminium oxide composites in 1890, the use of emery wheel became insignificant, which was a very practiced form of manufacturing process prior to that. Oxychloride bonded wheel was invented in England and rubber bonded wheel in US and France. Metal bonded diamond grinding wheel were introduced in early 1940. By the early 20th century, grinding wheel containing silicon aluminium oxide and silicon carbide were produced with vitrified rubber, shellac and oxychloride bonds. Super abrasive polycrystalline diamonds and cubic boronitride developed in the 20th century are being widely used nowadays for high precision grinding of ceramic, carbide, metals, glasses, fiber reinforced composites and variety of other materials. Nowadays, grinding has become a wide used process for major industrial application. We can see some from the images, we can see some very early use of this process. This is a wheel found in Egypt for the construction of the pyramids. The engravings were expected to be done using grinding process. Now, coming on to the process itself, grinding. Grinding is a material removal process used to shape and finish components of different metallic and non-metallic materials. The precision and surface finish obtained through grinding can be up to 10 times better than milling. Grinding employs a rotating abrasive tool, usually in form of a wheel brought into controlled contact with a work surface. Grinding wheel is composed of abrasive grains bonded together by an adhesive material. In this kind of abrasive machining process, material removal involves the interaction of abrasive grits with the workpiece at a high speed and shallow penetration depth, that is depth of cut. Due to its ability to produce fine chips, grinding is considered as a key process which has the benefit over most precision machining operation in the manufacture of components requiring smooth surfaces and close tolerances. Since the development of method for more precise casting and forging that enables to manufacture products that are nearer to final configuration, grinding has become established itself as an industrially more important process for machining the final dimensions without the necessity for prior turning or milling operation. Grinding also finds its importance in processing material having extreme hardness like glass, silicon wafers, etc. Microelectronic circuits are also finely ground with relative ease in ductile regime method to obtain a crack-free surface, again due to the high hardness of abrasive particles. Grinding is virtually an unparalleled operation for machining of hard materials, most of which are usually difficult to cut by other machining processes. With all the chip-forming machining processes, the output of the system during manufacture are generated from interaction between cutting edge and workpiece material. In grinding, this interaction is performed by abrasive grains, resulting in large number of microscopic chips. These abrasive grains, also known as grits, are particles having very huge number of undefined cutting edges, whose shape, orientation and distribution are random due to the manufacturing process of grinding wheel. The material removal process in grinding, which requires significantly higher amount of specific energy that results in excessive amount of heat generation, makes the process extremely complex. here we can identify the grinding wheel. This is a grinding machine, surface grinder, horizontal plunge surface grinding machine. This is the grinding wheel. Here we have, here we can see a silicon carbide wheel which is coming into interaction with this workpiece material, and sparks are being generated as the materials are being removed from the surface of the work material. Now, grinding is a relatively complex machining operation influenced by several parameters. During grinding, the material removal from the workpiece surfaces involves a combination of one or more of the following phenomena, that is the shearing, plowing and rubbing. A grain which has cut deep into the workpiece may carve out small chip, whereas a grain rubbing into the surface may not penetrate much into the workpiece. Another case may arise where the grain penetration where the grain penetrates and plows the surface, forming ridges without causing material removal. In up grinding, where the motion of the workpiece is in direction opposite to that of wheel rotation, abrasive grains rub against the workpiece surface rather than cutting due to predominant elastic deformation of the workpiece substrate. The substrate is the workpiece surface. This is called friction or rubbing stage. Subsequently, plastic deformation takes place as the elastic limit exceeds between the abrasive grain and the workpiece. This is called plowing stage. Workpiece material flows plastically through forward and sideward ahead of the abrasive grains and forms grooves. Here it can be seen like there are ridges where the work grit interaction has taken place, but the material hasn't been removed from here. When the workpiece material fails to resist the flow stress, chip is formed. This chip formation is called cutting stage, during which energy is used most efficiently. The main interaction during grinding are grit workpiece interaction, chip bond interaction, chip workpiece interaction and bond workpiece interaction. Considering the above work material interactions, knowledge about grinding wheel characteristics becomes an area of utmost importance, because as you might be knowing that in any other conventional machining operation, there is only a single interaction, that is the work and material work tool interaction. Here that interaction is being further divided down into four different interactions, and it is very critical or it is very complex to predict about the exact interaction which is being, or the exact action of the interactions which are listed over here. Now, coming on to grinding wheel characteristics. Now, abrasive particles are bonded together by an adhesive material that keeps the particles at desired place, and subsequently the shape and the structure of the wheel is established. During the process, nature of the grinding wheel is preset with the properties like type of abrasive material, size of abrasive particles, types of bond material and the porosity of the binding, which subsequently plays an important role while being applied in the material removal process. Grinding wheels are prepared from various types of abrasive materials in a wide range of sizes in conjunction with different bond materials and porosities. A typical representation of the specification of the grinding wheel can be seen in the slide. Here, this 51 and 23 are the manufacturer's code, which are for the manufacturer's use in order to identify the different batch numbers, etc., associated with the manufacturer of the wheel. The first term is abrasive type. Here, A stands for aluminium grits. It might be using silicon carbide, CBN, diamond, etc. Then this 36 is the number corresponding to the size of the abrasive grain. This L is the grade, 5 is the structure type, and V is the bond type which has been used in the wheel. We will now move on to understanding about the different specifications of the grinding wheel. First, we will start with abrasive type. An abrasive is small hard particle that have sharp edges and irregular shape. Unlike a typical cutting tool, abrasives are capable of removing small amount of materials from the work surface by a cutting process that produces small chips. Different type of abrasives are aluminium oxide, silicon carbide, diamond. Now, in order to study these in details, aluminium oxide first. These were first made in 1893 by fusing bauxite, iron filling and coke. These are the one which finds maximum use in the industry. Coming on to silicon carbide, first discovered in around 1891, I believe. It is made with silica sand, petroleum, coke and a small amount of sodium chloride. SiC abrasives are available in green, which are the more friable options, and black, which are the less friable option. Friability is the tendency of the grits to chip away or to break easily. These generally have a higher friability than aluminium oxide, hence they have a higher tendency to fracture and remain sharp. Or in other words, auto sharpening phenomena, that is the ability of the grinding wheel to break away at the periphery, and the grits at the subsequent layers to participate in the cutting action is higher in case of silicon carbide wheel compared to aluminium oxide. For this property, these wheels are generally used for materials like hard to cut materials like titanium, hastelloids, etc. Cubic boronitride, CBN. They were first discovered in 1870. They are very hard, tough and sharp, and they are also chemically very stable. Then comes diamond, industrial diamond, of course. Diamond, it was first used as an abrasive in 1955. It is extremely hard and sharp. It is very high heat and wear resistance. It is also produced synthetically, that is the industrial diamond. Nevertheless, it is not employed to machine ferrous material, as a basic component of diamond is carbon, and carbon have high affinity to iron. Hence, during grinding of ferrous metal by diamond, the diamond cutting edges would become blunt quickly. This phenomena is also known as graphitization of diamond. Now comes abrasive grain size. The grain size ranges from its corresponding mesh size of 10 to 600 for coarse grinding process. It might range up to higher number for more finer grinding processes. The size is determined by the size of mesh of a sieve through which the grains can pass. They are classified as coarse, medium, fine and very fine. Fine grain wheels are generally preferred for rapid metal removal on softer materials. The grinding size of the wheel plays a key role in grinding a given material for obtaining good surface finish and high accuracy of the workpiece. The SEM images of the different sizes of abrasive wheel can be seen in the image, and as the level of magnification is same for all of these pictures, it is very clear about the changing sizes of the abrasive cranes. Now coming on to grinding wheel grade. The strength of the bonding material to hold individual grain in wheel is defined by its grade, which is also a measure of the relative hardness of the wheel. This is accomplished by changing the amount of bonding material during the formation of grinding wheel. It has nothing to do with hardness of the abrasive particles. The hardness or grade of the grinding wheel is represented using symbol A to Z, with A representing maximum softness and Z maximum hardness. Then coming on to grinding wheel structure. The spaces, the abrasive grain are controlled during the formation of the wheel, as this is an important factor to have greater or lesser space between the grains in operation for grinding different materials. Here we can see that the open structured wheel, where the porosity is high, this is a medium structured wheel, porosity is comparatively lower than open structure, and this is a dense structure wheel where the porosity is further reduced. The term structure of the wheel comes from the density of the abrasive grains. An open structure wheel has fewer grains than a closed structure one. The structure of wheel is designed by number ranging from 1 to 15. Lower the number, the denser the structure will be, and higher the number, more open will be the structure. And these structure often plays an important role in controlling the strength of the wheel, as open structure will result into having lesser strength compared to dense structure. So in case of selection of grinding wheel for different materials, we may consider this grinding wheel grade and grinding wheel structure, as softer materials generally require harder, grinding wheels having higher strength, and harder materials generally employs grinding wheel having lower strength, as they gives facility to the wheel to undergo auto sharpening effect, where the grits dislodges by themselves and fresh new active keen grits come into action for material removal. Now comes bond material. Bond materials hold the abrasive grains and establishes the shape and structure integrity of the grinding wheel. Desirable properties of bond material include strength, toughness, hardness, and temperature resistance. Bond material commonly used in grinding wheel include vitrified bond, rubber bond, resinoid bond, shellac bond, metallic bond, etc. Out of which vitrified bond is very commonly used. These bonding material chiefly consists of ceramic materials. They are strong and rigid, resistant to elevated temperature, and relatively unaffected by cutting fluids. Now, rubber bond is most flexible of the bonding material. It is used as a bonding material in cut-off wheels or parting of wheels. The resinoid bond is made of various thermosetting resin material. They have very high strength and are used for rough grinding and parting off operations. Shellac bonds are relatively strong but not that rigid. They are often used in application required good surface finish so that newer grades may participate into the cutting action. Metallic bonds, usually bronze, are the common bond material for diamond and CBN grinding wheel. Diamond and CBN abrasive grains are bonded to the outside periphery of the wheel only, thus conserving the costly abrasive material. Grinding is a process which can be used for a wide variety of materials. They may be hard, they may be very hard, they may be very difficult to cut, but there are some inherent problems associated with grinding. Like numerous grit work interaction of predominantly negative raked grits at a high speed is generally associated with the operation. Thus, grindability, which is the ease with which grinding is performed, of a material is more complicated than machinability of the same material when they are compared on lathe, when they are processed on lathe or milling or shaper, etc. Grindability is defined as the ease of grinding on a given material where defect-free surface is generated without compromising with the production rate or productivity of the process. Being a complex process, there are many problems associated with the process, like high force requirement, specific energy requirement. As high force requirement, as we have seen in case of grinding, apart from the shearing operation, plowing and rubbing operation takes away or the consumes the energy, and also the grit work interaction or the unproductive grit work interaction is high. So force required for grinding is generally higher compared to other machining process. Similarly, specific energy requirement is also higher. Due to the high force requirement, high frictional forces, heat generation is also higher. The temperature associated with the grinding is comparatively much, much higher. Tempering and rehardening may happen due to the high heat generation. Residual stress may creep in due to the high heat generation. Then there is a problem of stiff air layer barrier, which forms in the periphery of the grinding wheel, as can be seen over here. This is the stiff air layer barrier which forms around the fast rotating grinding wheel, as the air gets sucked in from the periphery and comes out of the cutting surface. This layer is so stiff that we generally require some barriers or some measures in order to overcome the stiff air layer barrier and penetrate cutting fluids for smoother grinding operation. Then comes wheel loading. We'll be learning about wheel loading in the next slide. Then workpiece burn. Due to high heat generation, as it can be seen, a charred surface produced from grinding is shown over here. We can see that this workpiece should have been of this silvery color, but instead it has become of this charred black color due to the excessively high heat generation which was observed during grinding of titanium alloys or Ti6Al4V, that is grade 5 titanium alloy, using an aluminium oxide wheel. Now coming on to wheel loading. wheel loading is an important factor which hampers the effectiveness of the grinding wheel in material removal. In this process, tiny chips generating out of the workpiece substrate gets clogged into the integrate spaces here. The integrate spaces, the workpiece gets stuck in this integrate spaces and affects the cutting ability of the grinding wheel. Furthermore, this phenomena escalates while grinding is performed on advanced material or difficult to cut materials or ductile materials which possesses superior mechanical properties. This can be countered, this phenomena can be countered by proper wheel dressing. We'll be coming on to what is wheel dressing. Next slide. Prior to that, we may see that due to the formation of this cut, this wheel loading, the sharp grits actually acts as cutting edges where the friction increases. That's why the heat generation associated with this grinding further increases. Now, in order to remove the wheel loading, dressing is performed. Wheel dressing is carried out. Dressing is a process performed to improve the grindability of an abrasive wheel by removing the outermost layer, which becomes loaded and blunt due to its engagement in cutting action. Using a tool that exposes sharp new grits of wheel from subsequent layer. Dressing is an effective technique to increase the shearing ability of the cutting wheel and to reduce the unproductive rubbing and plowing action by chipping the grits at the surface, resulting in formation of micro cutting edges which facilitates further cutting. Before moving further, let us see a video for understanding this.
This is called a dressing. One type, there's another type, it's made of an industrial diamond. But this kind here, there's basically five disposable wheels in here that take a while to grind down, and all they do is spin a little bit and literally pound away on this stone. So let's go ahead and take a look at how this works.
As a grinding wheel, the dresser, when they are interacting with each other, a part of from the grinding wheel is being removed so that the fresh grits from the inner surfaces may come out and take part in the work material interaction zone. Now, there are different types of dressing processes developed with time. However, till date, only the traditional mechanical dressing process in which single point diamond tape is used as a tool has remained popular. This is not a single point diamond tool. This is a rotatory type of dresser. The single point diamond tool, due to its simplicity and low cost, has been such a popular option. Other available mechanical dresser which may be employed for this purpose are surface plate, multiple grain dresser, lock sharpeners, etc. Apart from this tactile mechanical dressers, there are also various type of dressing techniques which are non-tactile in nature, non-conventional in nature, like laser dressing that can be employed, ELID, that is electrolyte in process dressing. We'll be studying about these a little later in next lectures. Electric discharge dressing, wire electric discharge dressing, etc., which have been developed to cater the need more appropriately, avoiding the adversities associated with mechanical dressers like high heat affected zone, high material loss, low flexibility, and inefficient control over the process. Now, dressing with optimized parameters or better dressing tools may enhance the grandability to some extent, but challenges like high heat generation, thermal damage, generation of residual stresses, grit dislodgement, surface burn, etc. are generally like they shoot up during the grinding process due to the complexity of the process. These adversities can further be controlled with application of cutting fluids. The main aim of cutting fluids is to improve grindability through reduction of cutting forces and temperature. Involvement of these cutting fluids may increase or generally increase surface integrity and tool life. To emphasize the effect of cutting fluids, a scientist duo, Malkin and Stephen Malkin and C. Go, performed an experiment in, I think, Liverpool John Moose University, and they experimentally proved that for wet dressing, the energy partition was 16% with coarse grit wheel and 24% with finer grit wheel. This is for wet dressing condition. And similar studies for dry grinding reported that the energy partition reached nearly 59%, which is around 2 to 3 times higher compared to wet dressing. Now, this suggests that cutting fluid plays a very significant role in reducing the energy partition for grinding. Some of the usually applied conventional grinding fluid delivery techniques can be seen in the slide: flat cooling, drop by drop, under gravity, liquid jet, that is SQL, small quantity lubrication, mist cooling, minimum quantity lubrication, and through tool cooling or ZZ method in case of grinding. Another important thing that conventional metalworking fluids, which can broadly be classified as air blast, soluble oil with or without additives, thin mineral oil with or without suitable additives, etc., are often detrimental effects to environment by producing hazardous ambience even when applied in minimum quantity lubrication or small quantity lubrication stage, where the amount of cutting fluids is drastically reduced. Hence, selection of suitable environmental friendly cutting fluid is important. That should also be efficient and cost effective. Researchers are constantly trying to employ new and offbeat fluids which can improve grinding condition without affecting the environment unfavorably. Now, effects of cutting fluid. Now, principle of application of cutting fluids generally involve control of grinding zone temperature, that is cooling, lubrication of chip tool interface, that is lubrication, cleaning of the grinding zone, and protection of nascent finish surface. Now, these two are quite clear. Now, this application of cutting fluids may often result in removal of the debris of grinding, that is swaths of grinding, from the zone, making the zone clearer and cleaner so that some unwanted chip particles doesn't enter into the interaction zone. And if they get into the interaction zone, the cutting ability of the system reduces. Lastly, the protection of the nascent finish surface. Application of cutting fluids generally makes a protective layer on the nascent finish surface, a thin film layer of coolant on the nascent finish or the freshly finished surface, which reduces the chances of oxidation of the freshly finished surface. Now, usage of cutting fluid may improve the grindability to some extent, but there are some limitations of the action of these cutting fluids. First one is ineffectiveness. A study had shown that during flood cooling, only 3% of the coolant actually penetrates into the grinding zone or actually participates into the cooling and lubrication action. Then it may cause inconvenience to the workers, may impair the machining system, and also pollution of the zone and other health hazard to the operator. For example, in flood cooling, the amount of coolant which gets into the nearing environment of the machine is generally very hazardous to the operators. Then disposal problem and additional requirement of storage for cooling, filtration, recycling is also very high, which results in increased cost of the machining system. Now, in order to improve grindability, as we have studied that what is grindability, it is the ease with which grinding can be performed for a particular work tool combination under different set of environmental conditions. Now, in order to improve grindability, we may focus our attention on different work tool combinations, process parameters changing the speed, feed, depth of cut, application of cutting fluids using proper delivery techniques, generally adhering to MQL or SQL systems, and proper dressing techniques using proper dressing in feeds. The combination of these things will result in improved grindability of any material. The image of the grinding machine or the grinding process which we saw in the first few slides were that of a horizontal plunge surface grinder. That is a conventional grinding machine. Now we are going to study some special unconventional type of grinding machines. The first one is cylindrical grinding. Cylindrical grinding is the process of grinding the outside surface of a cylinder. This outside surface. These surfaces may be straight, tapered, as you can see, or contoured. Cylindrical grinding operations resemble lathe turning operation. They replace the lathe when the workpiece is hardened or when extreme accuracy and superior finish is required. As the workpiece revolves, the grinding wheel, rotating much faster in opposite direction, is brought into contact with the part. Both the workpiece and the wheel revolves or rotates, sorry. And they are brought into contact, each other's contact, and with the relative interaction, material removal occurs. The workpiece and the table reciprocates while in contact with the grinding wheel to remove material. Now let us now see a video to understand it better. This is the part where material removal is being performed with the interaction of this rotating wheel as well as this rotating workpiece. Now the next special grinding technique is centerless grinding. Centerless grinding machine eliminates the need of having center holes for work or to use work holding devices. In centerless grinding, the workpiece rests on a work rest table and is backed by a second wheel called the regulating wheel. The rotation of the grinding wheel pushes the workpiece down the work rest blade and against the regulating wheel. The regulating wheel, usually made of rubber bonded abrasive, rotates in the same direction as the grinding wheel and controls the longitudinal feed of the work when set in slight angle. By changing this angle and the speed of the wheel, the workpiece feed rate can be changed. Let us now see a video of centerless grinding. See, the sparks which are being generated are only coming to this side. This easily gives you the impression that only this wheel is taking part in cutting action. This only is provide the feed wheel over here, which provides a support in order to the cutting action on the centerless grinding machine. Now, third category is internal grinding. Internal grinders are used to finish straight, tapered or formed holes accurately. The most popular internal grinder is similar in operation to being considered to a boring operation on lathe. The workpiece is held by a work holding device, usually a chuck or a collet as in case of lathe, and revolved by a motorized headstock. A separate motor head in the same direction as the workpiece revolves the grinding wheel. It can be fed in and out of the work and also adjusted for depth of cut. Now let us see a video of internal grinding process. See, this is the chuck where the workpiece is held. This is the tool which is working on internal grinding of this surface. The shiny surface which you can notice is the processed part of the tool. The tool is rotating, also the workpiece is rotating, and with the relative interaction, grinding is being performed. Now, the last category is creep feed grinding. Traditionally, grinding has been associated with small rates of material removal and fine finishing operations. However, grinding also can be used for large scale material removal. As we know, the depth of cut of grinding is comparatively much lower than that of milling and lathe, cutting on lathe. So that is a detrimental effect. But in creep feed grinding, the depth of cuts are generally very high. Grinding also can be used for large scale material operations similar to milling, broaching and planing. In creep feed grinding that was developed in 1950s, the wheel depth of cut is as much as 0.25 inch and the workpiece speed is low. Its overall competitive position with other material removal processes indicates that creep feed grinding can be economical for special applications such as in grinding shape punches, twist drill flutes and various complex super alloy parts. The wheel is dressed to the shape of workpiece to be produced. Although generally one pass is sufficient, a second pass may be necessary for surface finishing. This is a very special technique of grinding, and let us see a video to understand this. This is a multi-axis creep feed grinding machine where the work, I think this is a 6-axis milling machine, grinding machine. Yes, and the workpiece is held over here, and this is the grinding wheel. This is the wheel with which diamond dressing roller, with which dressing is being performed, as well as down feed is given with this. There is the nozzle through which cutting fluid can be obtained. As you can see, this is a CNC type machine where tool adjustment or tool changes can be done automatically. This is the dresser. Dressing is done simultaneously in creep feed grinding. As the depth of cut is high, the wheel loading phenomena observed in this type of dressing is much higher to compared to conventional grinding operation. Now, this brings us to the end of lecture 1. I hope you have learned something about these processes, the grinding, and assignment will be floated at 1 p.m. on 11th of May 2020 in Google Classroom. Thank you.